Of course, we have target tallies. But we don't need to listen to this. Moving on, there we go. All right. So when you're playing with the light bulbs and the batteries, what you should have found is that you needed a complete circuit for this to work. You had to have some connection between the negative end of the battery, something through one part of the light bulb, either the tip or the side threads, which are also metal. Could have been this way as well. Okay, that would also work. And then that positive end of the battery. So you have to have a full, what's called a circuit, a complete loop. And the current comes out of that positive end, goes through one of the two parts of the light bulb, doesn't matter which one it goes through first, comes out the other part of the light bulb, your two parts of that metal tip and the metal threads, and then goes around to the negative end of the battery. The battery has a chemical reaction, which creates our electropotential difference, which gives us our current. So what do you need for a light bulb to light? You need a complete circuit. And this wire could have been a paper clip. It could have been a pencil lead. It could have been a metal chair. Hopefully you got imaginative and tried a couple things. Sometimes students try braces. Sometimes those work. So your results may vary. All right. You need that complete pathway. We call that a circuit. Current is the flow of charges through a wire. We consider it to be a positive flow of current, though it's really the electrons going the other direction. This is all Ben Franklin's fault. Remember the lab you did when you were rubbing the fur and the plastic and the silk and the glass rods? Benjamin Franklin had done those experiments, and when he played with the amber and the silk and the fur and the, it wasn't plastic, it was glass, he noticed that the amber and the glass behaved differently. He didn't know what was going on exactly, but he called one of them a positive, one was a negative. And then that got associated later to batteries and current flow. And it wasn't until we got down to particle theory and you found out, oh, look, it's really electrons that flow and they're going the other direction. There is no positive current flow. So we're going to still talk about positive current. Now that beeping you heard was the oven timer going off. My wife's birthday today. I was making cupcakes. So let's continue on. So while we talk about the positive current flow, just understand it's really the electrons. So here's what's going on. Here you've got a crystal structure. This is metal, it could be copper, gold, whatever. And you've got those atoms locked into place. The electrons, remember, can move around. And the idea behind a conductor is those electrons move around easily. And they can easily jump from atom to atom to atom. So when you put an electric field into the circuit, you know, hook up a battery to it. Remember, you get the high potential, low potential, creates an electric field between them, and that electric field goes through the metal. And I know earlier in the previous statics unit we said there's no electric field in a conductor. How can there be electric field in a conductor? There is an electric field in the conductor if you put it there. If you hook up a voltage potential difference, you do get an electric field in a conductor. And that's the phone. And we're back. Telephone solicitor trying to sell us a new roof. We just got one. All right. So when you have an electrostatic situation, the charges will move to the outside, no electric field inside. This is not electrostatics. This is electricity, where you're forcing an electric field with a power supply. Thus, it's different and different rules. So here we have the electric field. Remember, those electrons are free to move around from atom to atom to atom. But because there's an electric field, when they are loose between the atoms, they tend to move based on the direction of the electric field. So since the electric field is to the right, those electrons would be forced to the left. And they will generally move to the left once they're free of an atom. Of course, they'll get caught up by another atom, zip around that for a while, maybe get broken loose, drift a little bit more to the left again. So in general, they will move to the left. Okay, so that's the result of that electric field. That's what gives us current, is the electric field in a wire allows those electrons to drift in one direction or the other. The motion is very random, but there's a general trend for the electrons to tend toward that one direction. Now, the electrons are actually moving about 1,000,000 meters a second, but if we actually looked at one electron and tried to see how fast it traveled along that wire, it actually only goes a few millimeters per second on average, because of its movement being some to the right, some to the left, some up, some down. So we call it a drift velocity, because it kind of meanders that way. All right, so if it was just electricity and just the wires electricity would flow really easily. However, typically we're hooking up a circuit to make a light bulb light or a toaster work or a microwave work. So there's resistance to that flow because the current has to do something. So we're going to use an analogy here. And this analogy has to do, or is kind of set up as a bunch of dogs trying to get to that milk-bone dog biscuit. Okay, so let's say those dogs want to get over to the right, but there is only a small tube for them to go through. So only one dog can make it through at a time. All right, so there's the idea, is this tube is our resistor. It is resisting. It is resisting the flow of those puppies. I can only get so many puppies through at a time. So the shape, the size of this tube is our resistance. In order to make it bigger, or sorry, to allow more puppies to go through, we would have to change that tube. If we make it bigger, okay, bigger around, bigger opening, okay? A bigger opening would allow more puppies to go through at one time. So that would be reducing the resistance to the flow. There's more pathway for them. If we were to change what's inside the tube, instead of air, fill it with jello or cats or so hamsters or something, it would be harder for them to get through. So the type of material makes a difference. And if it were a longer cylinder and full of cats, all right, it would take the puppies that much, it would make it more difficult for them to get through. So it's the length of this object, the width of the object, how big an opening it has, and what it's made of that affects that flow of puppies. Obviously, we're going to translate that over to charges. That's why all those puppies are little negative puppies, because they're electrons. It's making it difficult for those electrons to flow through. All right, so that how big the opening is. We call that the cross-sectional area. If you're looking at it from that end, it's the area you would see. Length is how long that object is. And then the material would be yet another factor. So here's the equation we end up with. We end up with the resistance of any object is equal to this variable here is rho. Think like rho, rho, rho your boat. Looks kind of like a paddle. So that's rho times L divided by A. Rho is called the resistivity of material. And I'll talk about that in a minute. L is the length of it, how long is the object, and divided by A, that A is the cross-sectional area, how big an opening you have to travel through. So longer it is, the more the resistance of the material, you got to go through more. The bigger the area, the easier it is for stuff to flow through. And then this resistivity is a function of the material. So something like rubber, it's really hard for electricity to go through rubber, not impossible, but difficult. It has a very high resistivity. Whereas metal is very easy for electricity to go through metal, so metal would have a very low resistivity. So that's a function of what the material is made up of. Mr. Zarzek likes to call this equation the Pleia equation. That's how he rolls. There you go. And because we can, okay, that is an image you will never get out of your head. Never, ever, ever. Okay, so this equation allows us to take anything, say a cube of material, and pass electricity through one side to the other side and look at the distance it's traveling through that material. That'd be your L. Look at how big a pathway it has to go through. That's the A. And of course, what the material is made of is the rho. But there's one other aspect to think about, and that sometimes temperature has an effect. Some things, when you heat them up, the electrons transfer easier. Some, when you heat them up, they actually don't transfer as well. So there can be a temperature adjustment to the resistance. Now, this is not always true. So there are some things that they have one purpose and one purpose only, and that is to give a consistent resistance. The things that do that are called resistors. They tend not to be affected too much by temperature. And some of the problems you'll be doing on WebAssign won't talk about temperature at all. They'll just say, hey, here's an object, here's the dimensions of it, here's the length, the width, the height, figure out which two variables make up your A, what the third variable would make up your L, and you'd come up with your dimensions and you'd come up with the resistance. But sometimes a problem may say, well, temperature changes and you have a certain resistance at one temperature and a different resistance at a different temperature. So that's where a temperature adjustment comes in. Now, we can't just jump to the resistance equation and change the resistance, but it's what really changes is this, is the resistivity, because we're affecting the molecules, the atoms of the material. So we have this equation which adjusts that resistivity. Now, remember, only worry about the temperature if the problem says to. Don't try and shoehorn this equation in all the time. It's not always appropriate. So here we've got the resistivity of an object is about equal to the resistivity at a certain temperature, a base temperature, as it were, times 1 plus alpha delta T. Oh my God, there's so many variables. It's okay. They all have a place. Delta T is the change in temperature from our base design temperature. If it's above that base temperature, delta T is positive. If it's below that base temperature, delta T is negative. Now, wouldn't it be great if the base temperature was 0 degrees? That would make this easy. We would just say delta T is whatever T is, but that's not how it works. Our base temperature is 20 degrees Celsius. Why? Because 20 degrees Celsius is room temperature. So this is based on an adjustment from room temperature. So we call that our reference temperature. That alpha is how much it changes. Some materials hardly change at all, so alpha would be very, very small, you know, 0.00000 something. But some materials like filament in light bulbs, they change drastically. If we want to know what the alpha for most pure metals is, gold, silver, copper, it's 1 over 273 Kelvin. Don't worry about it. You'll never be asked to calculate this on your own. We provide you with alpha. We provide you with the rho naught. There's actually a table of temperatures in your textbook, and your WebAssign problems are based on that table in your textbook. Now, you can certainly Google these online. However, I caution you, the numbers you find online may not be exactly the same as what's in your textbook. For example, say tungsten. Maybe there's different flavors of tungsten. Maybe the books put one number and someone online came up with a different number from whatever source they had. So I would not rely on the numbers on the internet or on Google. I would use the numbers in your textbook because the WebAssign problems use the numbers in the textbook. So you don't want to, you know, struggle and keep getting the answer wrong because you use the wrong number. What I did is I found the table in the textbook, took a picture of it with my cell phone, and now I have a copy of that data table on my cell phone, so it's convenient that way. This says the table's on page 508. That might have been an old version of the textbook, so if that number's not right, look around, find the right number, feel free to email me the right number. I can change this file. Because we are changing the resistivity of the material, it changes the resistance. Think about it. If we plug numbers in here and we end up with twice as much resistivity because of this change in temperature, if you double the resistivity, you double the resistance. It's the same kind of change. So since they are the same change, we could also have an equation here that says R is about equal to R naught parenthesis 1 plus alpha delta T, just replace these with R's. So if we already know the resistance of 20 degrees, we'd have an R naught here, and that would give us our new resistance at the new temperature. So they're equivalent equations. Quite often we got to go this route, though, find that new resistivity. Remember, the delta T is your temperature above or below 20 degrees Celsius. So at 20 degrees Celsius, delta T is 0. It's not 20. I've seen that mistake happen a lot. So at 20, delta T is 0. 0 times this is 0, plus 1 is 1. 1 times this is this. So your resistivity at 20 degrees is whatever it is in the data table in your book. If, however, our new temperature, we heat it up to 100 degrees Celsius, and now we test it, well, now our delta T is 100 minus 20. It's 80, because we're 80 degrees above 20. So we'd have 80 times whatever alpha is, plus 1. Take all of that, multiply by the resistivity in the data table, and get you new resistivity. If we're at 0 degrees Celsius, well, 0 is 20 degrees below 20. So delta T would be negative 20, because 0 is down 20 from our reference temperature of 20. If none of that made sense, rewind, listen to it again. The variable we use for resistance is called ohms. So remember, voltage, we measure in volts. Current, we're going to measure in amps or amperes. The variable, unit for that is big A. The variable for ohms is this omega symbol. Resistivity, that rho here, is ohmmeters. Ohms times meters, not ohms per meters, ohmmeters. And that temperature coefficient alpha was in inverse degrees Celsius. Don't worry about that so much. You'll just see that in your data table. Okay, so there's your various variables and the units for your variable. All right, so this slide shows that equivalent equation. So here's our resistivity formula that if we have the resistivity at 20 degrees Celsius, but we're going to run at some temperature other than 20 degrees, we have our 1 plus alpha delta T. Remember, you multiply first, then you add, then you multiply. Order of operations is very important here. And you get your new resistivity at the new temperature. If you happen to already know the temperature at 20 degrees Celsius, then you can do that same calculation because you get the exact same change, increase or decrease, in resistance because they are proportional to each other. But if some Aubusson problems, this might actually help. Algebra tip, make sure you're doing your algebra right. It's the multiplication first, then the addition, and then the stuff outside the parentheses. Don't distribute the R naught because, say, you're trying to solve for the delta T, for example, or solve for the alpha. If you distribute that R, you have to divide by that R later. So if you're solving for something inside here, divide by the R naught, put that over here. Now you've got these things by themselves. You subtract 1, for example, then divide by alpha to get delta T, for example. Do faster algebra, streamline your process. Don't distribute when you don't need to. Okay, so here's a practice problem. We've got the resistance, or a resistor here, it has a length of 0.01 meters. We've got to work in meters. If we gave things to centimeters, you'd have to convert to meters first. Don't get caught on that. It's got a very small radius. We're looking at a small little object here. So we're looking for the resistance at 20 degrees Celsius. We look in our data table, we find, hey, the resistivity of this material is 4. And alpha is 0.7. But since we're at 20 degrees, we don't have to worry about the alpha yet. We won't need that until down here. So we know that resistance equation. And I can write it here. Remember, you've got it in your notes already. The resistance is the resistivity times length divided by that cross-sectional area. Since the current's going sideways through the cylinder, your cross-sectional area is the circle we're looking at here. Your circle has a radius of 0.001. Remember, the area of a circle is pi r squared. Got to know your basic geometry for this. So you'd have that for your area. Your length is that 0.01 meters. And your rho is going to be rho naught because we're at 20 degrees Celsius. Multiply that out, give it a shot, see what you get for resistance. Once you have that, now look at the resistance for the temperature is 30 degrees. That's 10 degrees higher. So remember that equation you've got written down. We've got your resistance at a new temperature is equal to resistance naught, resistance at 20 degrees, which is what you just calculated here, times parentheses 1 plus alpha delta T. Your alpha is 0.7. Your delta T is your temperature above or below 20. Your 10 degrees above 20, so your delta T is positive 10. So calculate that number, check it out. After you've done both of those, we continue on, and see if you got the answers right. So you'd get your 12,732.4 ohms at 20 degrees. And if we do the resistivity calculation, here's your 1 plus alpha delta T. We find our new resistivity is 32 ohm meters. Remember, it's not ohms per meter, it's ohm meters. We then plug this 32 in place of 4. Okay, it's 8 times bigger. That also means our resistance is 8 times bigger. So we could also have done that by using the alternate resistance equation. We've got the resistance at 20 degrees times the 1 plus alpha delta T. So check these out. Both methods are fine. It all really depends on which way you put it together in your own head and in your own notes. Now is the time when we all gather ourselves, we sit in our homes quietly, and we chant, Om, Om, Om. You can continue that now. Keep meditating, relax, and now we can move on. All right, so if resistors change resistance based on how big they are, you know, how long they are, what the cross-sectional area is, you might be a little surprised to see if you looked in a box full of resistors that had all different values, they actually all look like they're about the same size. So, well, how can they be different resistances if the size is the same? It turns out it's an internal thing. When you look at a little resistor, this is kind of a cross-cut, cross-section of one. They're not really just a solid chunk of material. They actually are a carbon spiral around a central core. The central core is an insulator. It's not part of the conducting part. So picture these being like a slinky wrapped around that core. So you got a spiral wrapped around it. And by printing this spiral here, the black part being the spiral, by printing it thinner, you're changing the cross-sectional area. Picture a hose wrapped around a post. And you can get more of them there because they're thinner. So by making these individual pieces thinner, you can fit more of them there, which makes the entire spiral longer. Longer and thinner means more resistance. So that's why they're the same size on the outside. It's just there's an internal construction to them that looks a little different. Carbon resistor. Might see this in the lab video, might not. Let me come back to that one, see if I can come up with some for that. This would be a simple circuit diagram. You can be diagramming things out. Remember you did one for a light bulb, you drew pictures of a light bulb, pictures of the wires, paper clips, things like that. There's more of a structure to it. So alternating long and short lines are a battery. Switches look like this, light bulbs, draw them something like this. And as you look at other stuff we have in our notes and lecture files and online, you'll see these kind of pictures showing up. This is not a simple circuit. This has diodes, maybe some transistors in it, switches, all sorts of things going on. Way beyond what we're going to do in this class. So we're going to stick with this. Okay. This is a zigzag left over from the last time I gave this lecture, apparently last year. Just as well it's there, because trying to draw this with my trackball is going to be a fun challenge. I'm going to give it a shot. Why not? A resistor looks something like this. We draw it as a zigzag. Remember what it looked like inside that resistor? So the zigzag really is just our way of showing, hey, there's a resistor here that's going to slow down the flow of electricity. Notice inside that light bulb, you see that same zigzag? Because a light bulb is just something that gives resistance, but its main purpose isn't to give a consistent resistance. Its purpose is to get really hot. Ha! You thought a light bulb was designed to give light. No! Light bulbs get really hot. The light is a side effect. About 95% of an incandescent light bulb's energy goes to making heat. Only about 5% goes to making light. And there's the phone again! So we show resistors as zigzags. Light bulbs as a circle with a zigzag inside. Batteries as alternating long and short lines. And switches like that. All right. Fancier versions here. This is also a light bulb, just no zigzag inside. But okay, so we talk about resistance being the resistance to flow of electricity. Now, what are voltage and current? Well, voltage is that electric potential difference. We've talked about that in previous units. So, and you used to it in your house. You got your 110 volts. You got batteries. You got your 9-volt battery. Little AA batteries are 1.5 volts. So we're used to voltage. We see that a lot. Current is that flow of electricity. We measure that in amps. So your circuit breaker in your house would be rated in amps. You might have a 5-amp circuit and a 10-amp circuit and a 15-amp circuit. And if any of those particular pathways in your house had too much current going through them, the circuit breaker would shut off because there's a limit to the amount of current that can go through that part of the circuit. If you put too much current through things, they tend to get too hot, melt, or cause fires. That's why you have circuit breakers in your house. Imagine if you tried to plug everything in your house into one outlet, a lot of extension cords and splitters and things like that. So much current would be drawn through that one section of wire, the wire itself would start to get too hot. And without a circuit breaker, it would literally start a fire, or melt, at least melt the metal if it couldn't get anything flammable. So there's a reason our houses are designed the way they are to distribute the load throughout the house over different circuits and have different circuit breakers. All right, so voltage is that electric potential difference that pushes current through a circuit. And the resistor resists the flow of current. In order to measure things like these, we use meters. A voltmeter measures voltage. Oh, what a surprise. And an ammeter measures current, or measures the amps. Now, there's very special ways we have to use these. Now, Mr. Zarzak is going to set up a video for the labs, and he'll be showing you some close-ups of some meters in his video, I believe. I'll try and give you kind of a heads up on what they're going to do here. So, remember, voltage is relative. We're measuring the voltage difference between two locations. So we can take a voltmeter, and this symbol here represents our voltmeter. We put one probe from the wire to one side of the light bulb, one probe from the voltmeter to the other side of the light bulb, and it measures the voltage difference from one side to the other. If we took the voltmeter and put it over here by the battery, it would measure the voltage difference across the battery. If it was a 12-volt battery, that might measure 12 volts. If this bulb needed 12 volts to run, we hooked up in the circuit with a 12-volt battery, it also would measure 12 volts. It's measuring the difference between the two. Remember, you got high potential and you have low potential. Voltmeters are easy to use. You don't have to disconnect the circuit. You just take your voltmeter and say, hey, I've got two wires coming out of the voltmeter. Touch here and here, touch here and here, touch here and here. I can get my measurements. Easy peasy, not a problem. Ammeters are going to be a little tougher. An ammeter, however. While voltmeters are measuring the potential difference between two locations, ammeters are measuring the current that's going through them. So we need to put the ammeter into the circuit so that the current, the electricity flowing through the wires, goes through our light bulb, then goes through the ammeter, then goes through the battery. Order doesn't matter. It could go from battery to ammeter to bulb, ammeter to bulb to battery. Where it is not an issue. But it has to do what's called in series, meaning all the current that goes through one has to go through the other, so they're in line. Which means we need to open up the circuit and make a space to put the ammeter in. So here we got snap. We are breaking open the circuit here and creating a gap. Once we have that gap, and here's our gap right there. Once we have that gap, we can take our ammeter, which has two wires coming out of it, just like the voltmeter did. And we bring our wires in to close that gap. Remember, our circuit had to be a full closed path. So let's close that switch just to really make sure we got a closed circuit here. There you go. Close the switch. So now we have a complete pathway, and the current that's coming out of the battery goes to the switch, goes to the bulb, goes to the ammeter, back to the battery again. So whatever current comes out of this goes into that. So our ammeter will measure that amount. If we didn't do it that way, and if we tried to, let's close our circuit here, and let's try and put our ammeter like we would a voltmeter, and say, oh, I'm going to put my ammeter over here and see what happens. Then I connect my wires like I do a voltmeter and do this. Well, now when that current leaves the battery, it's going to come along, go through the switch, and now it goes to here. It has two ways to go. It can go through the ammeter. And it can go through a light bulb. And the current that goes this way is not going through the ammeter, which means whatever goes through the ammeter, ammeter will say, hey, here's the current, 2 amps, 3 amps, 5 amps. We've got current, but that's not the current going through the light bulb. It's a different current going through the light bulb because you have two different pathways here. That's why it has to be in series or in line with it. So it goes through one and then into the other. If it's like this, this is called parallel, because it's two parallel pathways, then it splits, and you get different numbers in both pathways. As it turns out, ammeters themselves have a very, very, very small resistance. They have to, because if you put an ammeter in the circuit like this, and the ammeter had a big resistance, it would slow down the current, and the light bulb would go dim, and then you're getting a bad result, and that's no good. So ammeters have to have very little effect on the system. So ammeters, by design, have a small resistance, which means if we put it this way over here, you guys heard the phrase, I'm sure, things travel the path of least resistance. Well, since the ammeter has such a small resistance, a lot of current would go through the ammeter, and only a little bit of current would go through the light bulb, which means your light bulb wouldn't really light up, and you've broken the system, and it doesn't work. So this breaks the system. Things don't work well. Light bulb goes out, and all that current goes to the ammeter, and since there's no other resistors here, yeah, you can actually damage the ammeter if you do it this way. That's a bad thing. That's why we never hook ammeters up this way. It can damage them. So got to put them into your circuit so the current flows through. Remember that voltmeter. We have that voltmeter, and I'm going to see if I can sketch one here. So here's our voltmeter, and there's our voltmeter. Okay, great. So the voltmeter went in parallel like this, so that way I measure the potential difference from one side to the other, so you can tell the voltage across that light bulb. Well, voltmeters, by design, have a lot of resistance. They have a lot of resistance, so really no current to speak of goes through them, so all the current stays through the light bulb like it's supposed to, and the light bulb still works, and we haven't short-circuited the system like we would with the ammeter here. But that means if we put the voltmeter in this way in series, like an ammeter goes in, but a voltmeter has a lot of resistance, that means it stops the circuit from working and the light bulb goes dark. So putting a voltmeter in like this doesn't damage anything. It just makes the circuit not work anymore. And you don't get a good value in your voltmeter. So voltmeters must be hooked up, so they're measuring the difference from one side to the other. And ammeters must be in series, so they measure the current that goes through them. So they are used very differently, and you got to be really careful with that. This is what they look like. On the left, you see an ammeter. Notice it says milliamperes here because it's only measuring 10 milliamps, 500 milliamps. Remember, a milli is a thousandth, one thousandth of an amp. Amps tend to be small. So if we hook it into our system and we plug our sensor wires into the 500 and the black one here, we would read the numbers on the top and read that number of milliamps. So if the needle was right here. In fact, I'm going to draw a fake needle. Here we go. So here's our fake needle, like that. So we would read that to be about 450 milliamps if we were hooked up to this connector and this connector with our two wires, our probes. If we connected to this and this, it's always to the black and then one of the others. So we'd read the 100 numbers, which is here, halfway between 80 and 100, so that's about 90 milliamps. And if we connected into here, into the 10, we'd be reading about 9 milliamps. Over on the voltmeter, same thing. We've got 30 reads the top set of numbers, 3 reads the middle numbers, and 1.5 reads the bottom numbers. So depending on which connector is used, you read a different set of numbers. Now, unfortunately, you're probably not going to get a chance to play with these things. But we'll see what Mr. Zarzak's lab does for you. Maybe he'll make you read them in the lab. So the needle, if the needle was here, if we're reading on the 30, that'd be a 25. If we're reading on the 3 here, that'd be a 2.5. If we're on the 1.5, that's about halfway between the 1 and the 1.5, so about 1.25 volts. So the voltmeter is reading in volts. The ammeter is reading in milliamps because we want to work with small amperages. Voltage doesn't kill you. Okay, you can get 1,000 volts across you. I think when we did the Von de Graaff generator, that thing could be up around 5, 9, 10,000 volts. Huge amount of voltage, but it's not going to kill anybody. Because it's only going micro, micro, micro amps, very, very small current. Once you start to get to, I gotta look up the numbers again, but you can Google them, a certain amount, like 50 milliamps, something like that. I forget the exact number. Certain number of milliamps causes pain, a certain number of milliamps gets the muscles to contract, a certain number of milliamps kills you. So it's the amount of current going through your heart that stops your heart from working. The amount of voltage will determine how much current you get based on something else we're still going to learn, another equation. Okay, talked about reading the scale. Remember, ammeter has to go into the circuit. It has to have a very, very low resistance because of that. And the voltmeter has to go in parallel like this because it has a very high resistance. So the current doesn't go through it. It goes through your object that you're measuring. All right, how many milliamps are in an amp? Think to yourself, I already answered the question. Were you listening? 1,000 milliamps in one amp. If we have you do this lab, you're going to be writing down numbers that are on the resistor, and the numbers will talk about value of the resistor and the tolerance of the resistor. So in the next videos you see, pay attention to the data you get on the screen very carefully. And I think that takes care of our lecture notes here. This should be the entire period. We'll look at the WebAssign and see when we start giving you web assignments. WebAssign will be your class day that day. And we'll start working toward the next lab we're looking at, which is a video Mr. Zarzak's put together for you. So, as always, be safe, be good. I know this is, it's getting old for us guys, I get that, but those of you who went and saw our last play, Diary of Anne Frank, they were in that attic for over 700 days, and they didn't have Wi-Fi. So, I know we're saying, oh, I know it sucks, but someone else had it worse. I know, that's not the point I'm trying to get across, but you guys can do it. I know you can handle it. Stay strong, stay safe, and we'll be hopefully FaceTime with you guys, not FaceTime, but you know, a meetup sometime in the near future. All right. Take care, everyone.